السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته. الحمد لله رب العالمين، وأفضل الصلاة وأتم التسليم على سيدنا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه أجمعين. اللهم علمنا ما ينفعنا وانفعنا بما علمتنا وزدنا علما وفقها في الدين يا رب العالمين. اللهم اجعل جمعنا هذا جمعا مرحوما، وتفرقنا من بعده تفرقا معصوما، ولا تجعل فينا ولا معنا شقيا ولا مطرودا ولا محروما. اللهم صل وسلم وبارك على سيدنا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه أجمعين ومن تبعهم بإحسان إلى يوم الدين، آمين. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. The life of the Sahaba, the life of the companions of the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم, the aspects of their lives, the model of their lives, and what they had to do and what they understood of this religion to make it a model for the rest of this ummah. And some of the attributes of the Sahaba explain to us how much belief they have in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, His Prophet, and how they really understood the revelation of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, how they really understood the message. And that was, Jazakallah khair, akramakallah ya akhi, that was the only way we can understand how they were able to do what they did. And one of the attributes of the Sahaba is something that has been subject to debate even during the time of the life of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, a concept that some people can take to extreme and some people will forsake altogether, something that really many scholars spoke of. And we inshallah try to speak of that and try to explain some of that based on evidence from the Sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam and based on the lifestyle of the Sahaba, which is the main frame that we are modeling our current series over. And that is the subject and the concept of az-zuhd. Az-zuhd in Arabic and some of the translation into English really does not give you the full idea of az-zuhd, which is translated mostly as an ascetic way of life. It's to forsake the earthly life, forsake the dunya. The zuhd in Arabic means zahida fi shay'. To have zuhd in something is to really not give value to it. It's so you make zuhd to something, you have zuhd towards something, means you really don't have much value into it. And the zuhd is not to have a lot of value in life, in this material life that we live in, the things that we use, the things that we own, the things that we have, the materialistic aspect of life, is to not value that particular part. And that is really the meaning in Arabic of that particular word. Ibn Taymiyyah rahimahullah defined the word zuhd. He said, "Az-zuhdu tarku ma la yanfa'u fil akhirah." He gave a very short definition about az-zuhd. He said, "The zuhd is to forsake anything that is not useful in the akhirah." It's really a beautiful definition if you think about it. It doesn't mean not to have money, but if your money is not a tool that you use for your life after, for your hereafter, then you should really not have your heart into it. It doesn't mean not to have material things, but it's really, you have to use these things that you Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gave you in deploying that into the akhirah, into the hereafter. So Ibn Taymiyyah said, "Az-zuhdu tarku ma la yanfa' fil akhirah," is to forsake anything, is to leave anything that is not useful for you in the hereafter. The Sahaba radiallahu anhum, they did not have a definition for zuhd. Actually, when you go into the many hadith, there is no direct recommendation that the Prophet ﷺ said, "Usikum bizuhd," that you should have zuhd. But the meanings of these hadith is what the Sahaba understood, and that was how the concept of zuhd developed among the Sahaba. It is preferring, it is putting value in the hereafter. It's to have the life after is more preferable to this life, and to invest everything we have in this life for the service of our life later on. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, we start how the Sahaba took the concept of zuhud, beginning with the Qur'an al-Kareem, with the Qur'an, to the sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, including the hadith. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said in Surah Al-Kahf, about this life, about this dunya, just to give us an example, to give us similitude, وَلِلَّهِ الْمَثَلُ الْأَعْلَى. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, وَضْرِبْ لَهُمْ مَثَلَ الْحَيَاةِ الدُّنْيَا كَمَا إِنْ أَنْزَلْنَاهُ مِنَ السَّمَاءِ فَاخْتَلَطَ بِهِ نَبَاتُ الْأَرْضِ فَأَصْبَحَ هَشِيمًا تَذْرُوهُ الرِّيَاحُ وَكَانَ اللَّهُ عَلَى كُلِّ شَيْءٍ مُقْتَدِرًا الْمَالُ وَالْبَنُونَ زِينَةُ الْحَيَاةِ الدُّنْيَا وَالْبَاقِيَاتُ الصَّالِحَاتُ خَيْرٌ عِنْدَ رَبِّكَ ثَوَابًا وَخَيْرٌ أَمَلًا. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said in Surah Al-Kahf, and give them a similitude of this life, الحيات الدنيا. الدنيا is this current life. كما إن أنزلناه من السماء, like a rain poured down on earth from heavens. فاختلط به نبات الأرض, it mixed with the plant of the earth, meaning the plant grew based on that rain, benefiting from that rain. There we have plants that came out. فأصبح هشيما تذروه الرياح, and later on this plants become dry and it becomes hay blowing in the wind. وَكَانَ اللَّهُ عَلَى كُلِّ شَيْءٍ مُقْتَدِرًا, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is most capable of all things. And that means that this is also all what you see here in this dunya, all what you see around you of all these great buildings, of these great agriculture, industry, and everything that was before and to come later on, is transit. It's something that comes in for a short period of time, just like that plant that grew out of the rain and then dried out, and then it's gone. It became, it was blown in the wind. And then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, الْمَالُ وَالْبَنُونَ زِينَةُ الْحَيَاةِ الدُّنْيَا. Money, the belongings, the wealth, and the children are ornamentation of this life. Something that beautifies this life, makes people love it. زِينَةُ الْحَيَاةِ الدُّنْيَا, it's ornamentation. People love what they have. People love their children. And people love their belongings. People like their houses, their cars, their bank accounts. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, this is ornamentation for this life. المال والبنون زينة الحياة الدنيا والباقيات الصالحات خير عند ربك ثوابا. But the good deeds, the things that actually last, because this is all will go away. All this, all whatever money anybody has, all these belongings is gonna go. But Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala called the rest of it الصالحات, the good deeds. He said الباقيات, the things that stay, the things that actually last forever. الصالحات والباقيات الصالحات خير عند ربك ثوابا. They are better with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. They have better reward with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. وخير أملا, and more hopeful. So when you put your hopes, you put your endeavor on something, put it on something that would last. Don't put it on something that's gonna go away. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is telling us, this is good. المال والبنون زينة الحياة الدنيا. It's all beautiful in this dunya. والباقيات الصالحات. But the things that are everlasting and good with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala are better and more hopeful for the person. Meaning that when you put it in the account of the akhirah and the hereafter, you know that's gonna last for you. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said about this dunya in Surah Al-Hadid, أَلَمُوا أَنَّمَا الْحَيَاةُ الدُّنْيَا لَعِبٌ وَلَهْوٌ وَزِينَةٌ وَتَفَاخُرٌ بَيْنَكُمْ وَتَكَاثُرٌ فِي الْأَمْوَالِ وَالْأَوْلَادِ. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, no, let it be known to you that in this life, الْحَيَاةُ الدُّنْيَا لَعِبٌ, it's but a play, wasting time in this if we don't invest it in the right track. لَعِبٌ وَلَهْوٌ, joy. وَزِينَةٌ, and ornamentation, decoration. وَتَفَاخُرٌ بَيْنَكُمْ, it's competition amongst you. It's more, it's a place for having more pride among each other. It's a competition. Who's got the bigger house? Who's got the bigger car? Who's got the better, he's got more children? Whose children are doing better in school than the other? There's always this, you know, تَفَاخُرٌ بَيْنَكُمْ. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, and this is really truth. These are the words of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Now we all can deny this at one point or another. But if we reflect on what happens among people in all societies, we see that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the truth and says the truth. إِنَّمَا الْحَيَاةُ الدُّنْيَا لَعِبٌ ولهو وزينة وتفاخر بينكم وتكاثر في الأموال والأولاد. And multiplying, increasing, and working on increasing your wealth and your children. كمثل غيث. Again, the same similitude. كمثل غيث is like a rain came from the sky. كمثل غيث أعجب الكفار نباته. Like a rain that the الكفار here doesn't mean the unbelievers. الكافر in Arabic also can means the farmer. Okay? Because kafir, just digress a little bit to explain that meaning. Al-kafir is somebody who hides something. Okay, so those farmers who hide the seeds and the ground, they're called kuffar. Okay, because the kafir hides the fitrah, hides the true fitrah, the true nature that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has given him, which is to say, la ilaha illallah. If you leave, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, kullu mawludan yuladu ala al-fitrah. Every person is born to the true nature of knowing that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is one and there is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And if you even see the atheist, when they're in trouble, they say God. They ask for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And all the people, they always, when you get really into trouble, your heart is towards Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And I've seen it, wallahi, with my own eyes. We had some atheists that I knew, and when they got in trouble, they asked for Allah. Subhanallah. But this is the kafir. The kafir is somebody who hides that nature. And the farmer is somebody who hides the seed in the ground. So, أعجب الكفار نباته. It's like a similitude of rain that came from the sky, and then the farmer saw what growed out of it and liked it. They really admire what they have. Like we admire what we have and hold dear to it and try to protect it. We try to protect our wealth, we try to protect our houses, we try to protect what we have. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, أعجب الكفار نباته. Whatever grew out of that rain, those farmers liked it, admired it. ثم يهيج. Then it turned around, then it changed. فتراه مصفرا, it became yellow. You see what happens to the lawns and the trees in the fall and the winter. It becomes yellow and it falls out. فتراه مصفرا ثم يكون حطاما, and it becomes a wreckage, it becomes nothing. It goes away. All this greenery that you see now in the spring and later on in the summer, when you go check it again in the winter time, it's gone. Just you see dry branches. ثم يكون حطاما, and it all will go away. This is the dunya. It's all going away. Nothing will stay. Nothing will be left. وفي الآخرة عذاب شديد, and in the hereafter there is great torment from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. ومغفرة من الله, and there is also a lot of forgiveness from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. ورضوان, and pleasure, happiness coming from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. وما الحياة الدنيا إلا متاع الغرور, and this life is only substance to fool those who do not think about that destiny. Sa'id ibn Jubayr. Sa'id ibn Jubayr is one of the great tabi'een, the second layer that followed, the second generation that immediately followed the generation of the Sahaba, and they took their teaching directly from the Sahaba radiallahu anhu. Sa'id ibn Jubayr said the same thing that Ibn Taymiyyah said about mata' al-ghurur. He said, mata' al-ghurur ma yulhika an talab al-akhirah. This only the things that actually take you away from seeking the hereafter. These are the things that will be gone astray. These are the things that will be destroyed by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And those are the things that were followed by the wrath of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. But everything that was invested in seeking the hereafter is blessed by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. مَغْفِرَةٌ مِنَ اللَّهِ وَرِضْوَانٌ. Give forgiveness from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and the pleasure of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala speaks of the human nature. And that's what the zuhud is all about. The zuhud is to overcome those desires. To love and have it now. I want it all and I now want it now. This is an American concept, right? I want it. I want everything, but I want it now. And this love and this the heart that goes out just to achieving that. And if you can't achieve it, then you have to be on Prozac. You have to be on antidepressants. If you can't really achieve what you set out to achieve, and that is to have the wealth and to have the... And this is the love of this shahawat, this desires. And so a zuhud is to overcome, to forsake This atheistic way of life is to overcome this love of the desires that you want to have things right now in life. And if you don't have it, you're miserable. And if you have it, you're happy, but you want more. Not you're only happy, but you really want more. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, this is the human nature. In Al-Imran 14, it's two beautiful verses in Al-Imran 14 and 15. زين للناس حب الشهوات من النساء والبنين والقناطير المقنطرة من الذهب والفضة والخيل المسومة والأنعام والحرث ذلك متاع الحياة الدنيا والله عنده حسن المآب. In 14 Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said زين للناس, it was made beautiful for people, حب الشهوات, the love of the desires of women, والبنين and the children, والقناطير المقنطرة and piles upon piles of gold and silver, من الذهب والفضة, full of wealth, you know, all these things that we see on today's media, and it's being fed into the brains and the hearts of our children and ourselves, those, you know, the women that are out there and you know, we don't need to talk about that, but you can see, just flip on the TV and say, Astaghfirullah al-Azim, what goes on national media, on national TV. Min al-Nisa, wal-Baneen, and the children. Everything's for the service of our children, and people dedicate for their life just to the service of their children. And we will see what is the difference between that and the concept of zuhud. The concept of this zuhud doesn't mean don't care about your children. Doesn't mean don't go to work. And don't try to acquire wealth. And that's what we're trying to explain here in this session, inshallah. But don't make that your whole life. I met with one person on a trip, and he had just sent last one of his children to college. And he said, my life is totally empty now. I don't know what to do. My whole life, all I did is take him to baseball game and basketball game and go to schools and just dedicated everything, and now they're all gone and they're all out of college and I have nothing. He was very, very sad. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, this is the dunya. This is something that you're required to take care of your children, but that's not everything that should be in your heart. The akhirah should be there. The work for the hereafter. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is telling us, زين للناس حب الشهوات من النساء والبنين and the children والقناطير المقنطرة من الذهب والفضة. That includes all types of wealth. Doesn't have to be through, you know, gold. It can be stocks, it can be property, it can be real estate, it can be farms, it can be anything. والخيل المسومة and the beautiful horses. Now you just take the similitude of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and make that into beautiful cars. You know, we don't have horses, but this is the things that we ride. Although right now there are many people that actually spend millions of dollars on beautiful horses. Well, خيل مسومة والأنعام والحرث, and the cattle and the farmland. You know, the farm, the harvest of the farmland. This is everything out there, wealth-wise. ذلك متاع الحياة الدنيا. Allah Subhanahu wa Taala said, that is the pleasure of this life. That includes all the pleasures of this life. Is your house, your ride, whatever you ride, whatever you, wherever you live, whatever wealth you have, and whatever comes to your house out of, you know, farm products and agriculture. That's it. ذلك متاع الحياة الدنيا والله عنده حسن المآب. But Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has a more beautiful end. So what is that? Next ayah. قُلْ أَوْنَبِّئُكُمْ بِخَيْرٍ مِّنْ ذَلِكُمْ. Should I not tell you about what is better than all of that? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala immediately in the next ayah said, I will tell you what is better than all of this piles of silver and gold. What is better than the children? What is better than the harvest? What is better than the cattle? قُلْ أَوْنَبِّئُكُمْ بِخَيْرٍ مِّنْ ذَلِكُمْ. قُلْ أَوْنَبِّئُكُمْ بِخَيْرٍ مِّنْ ذَلِكُمْ لِلَّذِينَ اتَّقَوْا عِنْدَ رَبِّهِمْ. For those who have taqwa, who have fear with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, جَنَّاتٍ تَجْرِي مِنْ تَحْتِهَا الْأَنْهَارِ. It's the gardens of paradise with rivers flow underneath it. خالدين فيها. They have eternal life in it. وأزواج مطهرة. And purified spouses. ورضوان من الله. And pleasure with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. وَاللَّهُ بَصِيرٌ بِالْعِبَادِ. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is all-seeing over His servants. So the scholar said, the zuhud, this lifestyle, this concept of zuhud in Islam, it's not about wearing something rough or eating something tough. It's not about downgrading your life. Although we will see some of the Sahaba did that, and they did it for a purpose, and we'll have to understand that. They downgraded things that they could do better. For two things, for fearing Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, like Umar ibn Khattab. All his income was from the treasury of Muslims. So anything he will spend as a Khalifa has to come from there. He had no job when he was a Khalifa other than a Khalifa. So he had no source of income other than the treasury of Islam. So he took the bare minimum out of that because it's Muslim money. And we will say how they downgraded that life and why they wore the rough clothes and they ate the minimum that they could do. And the scholar said, zuhud is not to try to work or achieve goals in this life. He said, I'm a zahid, I don't want to go to school. You know, children can say, I don't want to be a physician or a lawyer because I am zahid. I don't want this dunya. That's not zuhud. You know, this is what the scholar is saying. You have to clarify this. And if it's not about depriving ourselves voluntarily from things that are available to us and they are halal. We know the story of the three people that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam knew about them. And they asked about the worship of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. سألوا عن عبادة رسول الله فتقالوها. They heard what the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam used to do, and they felt that is not enough. So they vowed for themselves to not eat meat. One of them said, "I will not eat meat or eat anything greasy or fatty. I will just I will make this haram for me." And the other person said, "I will not marry women. And I want to live a life of celibacy. I will deprive myself from that pleasure for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala." Right? And the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, when he heard of their voluntary vows, he said, أَلَا إِنِّي أَتْقَاكُمْ لِلَّهُ كَمَا قَالَ رَسُولُ اللَّهِ صَلَّى اللَّهِ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمَ. I'm the one that fear Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala the most among you. I'm the person that knows Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala the most. أَلَا إِنِّي أَصُومُ وَأَفْطِرُ. I fast and I eat. I break my fast, I eat. وَأَقُومُ وَأَنَامُ. And I make the prayer at night, and then I sleep also at night. Because the other person, the third person, said he will not sleep at night. He will just spend all the nights praying to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. There's nothing wrong with that, right? I mean, these are all good deeds. But Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, this is not the way. He said, وَأَكُلُ اللَّحْمَ وَالدَّسَمُ. And I eat meat. وَمَنْ رَغِبَ عَنْ سُنَّتِي فَلَيْسَ مِنِّي. Those who do not follow my tradition, my sunnah, they are not from me. So to take these things to extreme without a reason, Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, this is against the sunnah, this is against the tradition of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. But what is the zuhud about dunya is if we have those pleasures and they're gone, then the heart will not be saddened by not having them anymore. Or if we aspire to achieve something in this dunya, and it doesn't happen. My dream is to build a palace somewhere and have 200 bedrooms, for example. And you only, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gave you only 4-bedroom house, right? And people can be miserable with that. So what is the zuhud? The zuhud said, one of the scholars said, الزاهد لا يفرح من الدنيا بموجود ولا يأسف منها بمفقود. He said, the zahid doesn't have pride and pleasure of the things of dunya. Doesn't feel he's better than others because of the things that have in this dunya. الفرح, the word فرح doesn't only mean happiness but also mean pride. وَلَا تَمْشِي فِي الْأَرْضِ مَرَحًا. So this words means people that get this wealth, the wealth from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the bounty from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, that's always material. It can be knowledge. It can be children. You know, people, this was, especially in a tribal society, how many children you have gave you the highest stature in the society. So this is all from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And it's not a cause for pride by the person. So person that has the true zuhd in his heart, لا يفرح من الدنيا بموجود, doesn't have the pride if Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gave him something. ولا يأسف منها على مفقود, and doesn't become sad if something is gone away. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, لكي لا تأسوا على ما فاتكم ولا تفرحوا بما آتاكم والله لا يحب كل مختال فخور. To explain this concept, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, لكي لا تأسوا على ما فاتكم. If something that you missed, you either didn't get it in the first place or you had it and it's gone, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, you should not be sorrow of it. That should not be a cause of sadness in your life. You don't need Prozac. If Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala took you a beautiful car and you have a smaller car, because this is dunya, this is transit, you know. وَلَا تَفْرَحُ بِمَا آتَاكُمْ, and don't be proud, arrogant, have a cause of arrogance with what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has given you. I have more muscles than you, I have more wealth than you, I have more knowledge than you, I'm better than you. You know, the first sin of Iblis is he said, أَنَا خَيْرٌ مِّنْ, I'm better than him, I'm better than Adam. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, don't try to say I'm better than anybody else with things of this dunya. Because the scale with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is only about taqwa. Someone is better than the other one with taqwa, with the fear of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, with the piety. And only Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala can judge that. How can we say you have 5 pounds of taqwa and this other person has 7 pounds of taqwa? I mean, this doesn't make, you know, only Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala can tell who has more taqwa. إِنَّ اللَّهَ لَا يُحِبُّ كُلَّ مُخْتَالٍ فَخُورٍ. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala does not like anybody who is boastful and arrogant. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, وَاللَّهِ مَا الْفَقْرُ أَخْشَى عَلَيْكُمْ, I'm not afraid, I don't fear for you poverty. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, I'm not afraid that you will be hit by calamity, by poverty. وَلَكِنِّي أَخْشَى أَن تُبْسَطَ الدُّنْيَا عَلَيْكُمْ كما بسطت على من كان من قبلكم فتنافسوها كما تنافسوها فتهلككم كما أهلكتكم. This hadith is narrated in Al-Bukhari, Muslim, Ahmad, Tirmidhi and Ibn Majah. Very strong, authentic hadith. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, I'm not afraid for you this poverty, but I'm afraid that the dunya will be open for you. This life will be open. You will get wealth of this dunya, this ummah. كما بسطت على من كان من قبلكم, like Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tested those who before you with giving them wealth. This ummah has a lot of wealth, brothers and sisters, a lot of wealth, the ummah of Islam. كما بسطت على من كان من قبلكم, this dunya will open for you like it opened for those who before you. فتنافسوها, so you compete in it, then it becomes your work, it becomes what you're busy with doing every day, is trying to compete, get better in this dunya. فَتُهْلِكُكُمْ كَمَا أَهْلَكَتْكُمْ, then you will perish like those before you perished from lack of taqwa. Abu Huraira radiallahu anhu, this hadith is narrated in Al-Bukhari that the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, تَعِسَ عَبْدُ الدِّينَارِ وَالدِّرْهَمْ وَالْقَطِيفَةِ وَالْخَمِيصَةِ إِنْ أُعْطِيَ رَضِي وَإِنْ لَمْ يُعْطَ لَمْ يَرْضَى. The Prophet ﷺ said in this beautiful hadith, said, how miserable is he, the servant of dinar, the slave of dinar, slave of the dollar, right? He said, he's a miserable, what a miserable existence. The slave of a dirham wa dinar, the slave of money, wal qatifa, and the good clothes, wal khamisa, all the decoration, ornamentation, in u'tiya radi, when he has them, when he has all these things, this life, material things, he's happy. Or she's happy. This is talking about a slave of Allah. When they have all the good things and the beautiful things and the money and the good clothes, they're happy. وَإِلَّمْ يُعْطَ لَمْ يَرْضَى. But if they don't have it, they're not happy with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And that is exactly the opposite of zuhud. This is anti-zuhud as definition. Is if we have these wealth, these material things, we're happy. We're fine. And we want more. But if we don't have them, then we're miserable. So the heart is not connected with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. The heart is connected with the money, the heart is connected with the clothes, and the heart is connected with the belongings of this dunya. And Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, لو كانت الدنيا تعدل عند الله جناح بعوضة ما اشتقى منها كافرا شربة ماء. He said, if this dunya is worth with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala the wing of a mosquito, then an unbeliever would not be given one glass of water. This is worthless in the eyes of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. All the things that people kill each other for, and spill the blood, and steal, invade each other, for these things, they're worthless with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Doesn't work a wing of a mosquito. It's not worth a wing of a mosquito. And the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, مَا لِيَ لِلدُّنْيَا إني إن مثلي ومثل الدنيا كمثل راكب قال في ظل شجرة ثم راح وتركها. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, why do I need the dunya? Why do I have to have the dunya? The similitude of me and this dunya, like a traveler who rested in the shadow of a tree, took a nap, took a rest, and moved on. That's the dunya. It's that shadow of the shajara. If you are traveling, if you have a connection, let's say you're going to New York and you have to have a connection in Atlanta, would you stop in Atlanta airport and buy a house there? Trying to build a house? This is the dunya. It's a stop. So rest on the way to the akhirah. And that's what the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said. And then he defined what we want out of this dunya. What do we need this dunya for? The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, and this is hadith hasan, it's a good hadith, in Ibn Majah wa Tirmidhi. من أصبح منكم آمنا في سربه معافا في جسده عنده قوت يومه فكأنما حيزت له الدنيا. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, three things if you have, like you have the dunya. You have the entire good that can come out of this dunya. من أصبح منكم آمنا في سربه. Those who get up in the morning and they are secure, they're safe in their environment. And many people, they're not safe in their environment. I mean, their wars, their invasions, their bombs, you know. But those who have safety, alhamdulillah, like, you know, we do in this society. One thing he said, you have to have al-amn, the safety, the security. Mu'afan fi jasadi, and you have the health in your body. You have security, health, وَقُوتُ يَوْمِهِ وَعِنْدَهُ قُوتُ يَوْمِهِ, and you have the food for the day, فَكَأَنَّمَا حِيزَتْ لَهُ الدُّنْيَا, like you have the whole, your whole earth, like you have the whole good that come out of this dunya. And in another hadith that the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, he was asked for more money by Hakim bin Huzam. He wanted money from the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and he gave him money. So he came to the Prophet again and asked him for money, and the Prophet gave him more money. And then he asked the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam for more money, and then the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, Ya Hakim, إن هذا المال خضرة حلوة فمن أخذه بسخاوة نفس بورك فيه ومن أخذه بإشراف نفس لم يبارك له فيه وكان كالذي يأكل ولا يشبع. He said, this money that you have, that you are giving, it's a beautiful greenery, something that you can really use for a lot of good things. The greenery in the desert society means all the good things that you can have, because it's really the source of all wealth. And this is what the Prophet ﷺ is telling that man who understands that concept. It's like a beautiful greenery that you're getting from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. If you take it generously, how you take something generously? You take it and you're ready to give it out. You don't let it go into your heart, right? When you take, you usually give generously. But the Prophet ﷺ said, مَنْ أَخَذَهُ بِسَخَاوَةِ نَفْسِ. Those who take it generously, they take it and they're not hooked to it in their hearts. They take it, it's in their hands, but it's not in their hearts. بورك له فيه. They will be blessed. That money will be blessed for them. ومن أخذه بإشراف نفس لم يبارك له. Whoever took it out of greed, then there cannot be any blessing in that money. So the zuhd is to avoid the greed. To avoid the greed. I want it. I want more. And the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said that if Ibn Adam was given, this is in Bukhari and Muslim, لو كان لابن آدم واديان من ذهب, if the son of Adam had two valleys of gold, لابتغى لهما ثالثا, he would want a third one. He would want a third valley of gold. ولا يملأ جوف ابن آدم إلا التراب. And nothing can stuff up the greed of the son of Adam, can fill the son of Adam except dust, except turab, dirt. ويتوب الله على من تاب. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala repent on those who Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala would repent on. And the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, قد أفلح من هداه الله إلى الإسلام وكان عيشه كفافا فقنع به. Those who Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala guided to Islam, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gave them their sustenance, their share of His sustenance, of His rizq, and they were satisfied with it. They were satisfied with what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, they were happy with Allah, they were pleased with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, they had the qana'ah, the satisfaction. They were satiated by what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has given them, they have the falah, they are the successful. So if we go to the life of the Sahaba, how did they understand that concept? And what that concept meant to them? Starting with some of the Sahaba that had a lot of money. They were wealthy Sahaba. Like Abu Bakr as-Siddiq radiallahu anhu, Uthman ibn Affan radiallahu anhu, Abdul Rahman ibn Auf radiallahu anhu. These are not poor people. These are wealthy people. But they took this wealth that they have and never let it go into the heart. Never let that wanting of dunya, that greed go into their hearts. And they kept their wealth in the hands so they can use it in the way of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And we have also many of the Sahaba that they did not have much wealth, but how they dedicated their lack of attachment to dunya to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Because if you are to define the zuhd, it should be no attachment to dunya. The heart cannot be attached to this dunya, no matter how much we have. But that's a difficult test. The more you have by nature, the more attached to the dunya you will be. And this is what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said. It's been they're beloved to people, these things. These things people love by nature. And the only way to overcome it is taqwa. Is to fear Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and have piety with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam himself was an example of that. On the authority of Umar ibn al-Khattab, and this is was narrated in Book of Al-Hakim, and the degree of the authentication is sahih on the conditions of Imam Muslim radiallahu anhu. Umar said, استأذنت على رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم. He said, I took permission and I went to the room of the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم. وَإِنَّ بَعْضَهُ لَعَلَى التُّرَابِ. Part of his body was on dust. He had now enough rug in his house that he can sit on. So part of his body was on the dust. وَتَحْتَ رَأْسِهِ وِسَادَةٌ مَحْشُوَةٌ لِيفًا. And under his head, there was a pillow that is so rough. It's filled with rough material. And then, فَسَلَّمْتُ عَلَيْهِ فَجَلَسْتُ. And I made the salam of the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم, and I sat down. And I said, أَنْتَ نَبِيُّ اللَّهِ وَصَفْوَتَ. You are the Prophet of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And you are His chosen one. وَكُسْرَى وَقَيْصَرَ عَلَى سُرُرِ الذَّهَبِ وَفُرُشِ الدِّيبَاجِ وَالْحَرِيرِ. He said, and then Kisra and Qaisar, Kisros and Caesar, they are on their beds of gold and the mattresses of silk. How come? How come you are the best of creation on the dust, on the dirt, and this rough rug? And those people who are unbelievers are on the silk and gold. And the Prophet ﷺ said in one narration, أما ترضى أن تكون لنا الآخرة ولهم الدنيا? Wouldn't it satisfy you that we have the hereafter? We have the things that actually will last. And they will have the things that will go away. They will have the dunya. And in another, Rasulullah صلى الله عليه وسلم said, أولئك عجلت لهم طيباتهم. The good things have been hastened to them. This is all they're going to have. This is all the good that they will have for their creation. And everything else will be torment from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Umar ibn al-Khattab, رضي الله عنه, he did the lesson and he understood that from the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم. One time, Salim ibn Abdullah came to him and he saw what Umar ibn Khattab was eating as a Khalifa. He was eating some rough food. And he asked him, why are you doing this? He said, you have now the kingdom of Persia and you have defeated the Byzantines. Now Umar ibn Khattab became the ruler, the ruler of the superpower of the world. He said, you eat this rough food? And Umar ibn Khattab said, wallahi, I can order a goat and it will be slaughtered for me and it will be grilled over the, the butter and mixed with the raisins. And he gave him like a recipe. And the man said, wallahi, inna amir al-mu'mineen bi tayyib al-ta'am la khabir. Amir al-mu'mineen knows how to eat well. Then why are you eating this? Why are you eating this rough food? And then Umar radiallahu anhu, he said, سَمِعْنَا اللَّهُ سُبْحَانَهُ وَتَعَالَى يَقُولُ أَذْهَبْتُمْ طَيِّبَاتِكُمْ فِي حَيَاتِكُمْ الدُّنْيَا. Said to the kuffar that you have wasted your good things in the life. You wasted all the pleasures in this life. And in another narration, Umar ibn Khattab radiallahu anhu, he said, that I had two people that are my companions, meaning the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and Abu Bakr as-Siddiq after him. He said, if I don't do what they did, I'm afraid I will not be with them. If I don't live on the same life that they lived, I'm afraid I cannot catch up with them. And Umar ibn Khattab one time made tawaf around the Kaaba, and he had in his garment 12 patches. The garment that he wore was so used that had 12 patches of material in it. And then one time he was late for the Jum'ah, and then people said, why are you late? And he said, habasani thawbi. He said, I was late because of my garment, because I have no other garment to wear, and I washed it for the Jum'ah and it didn't dry, so I had to wait till it dry so I can wear it and I can come to Jum'ah. And he was the Khalifa. He was the Khalifa of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Even his daughter Hafsa radiallahu anha, Umm al-Mu'mineen, she came to him and she said, Inna Allah akthara min al-khayr. The Muslim Ummah now is so wealthy. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has given us all that wealth. Wa awsa'a alayka min al-rizq. فَلَوْ أَكَلْتَ طَعَامًا أَطْيَبَ مِنْ ذَلِكَ وَلَبِسْتَ لِثِيَابًا أَلْيَنَ مِنْ ثَوْبِكَ. He said, if you eat something better than what you're eating, and you wear something that is better than you wear. And he said, I will let you be the judge of that. He said, سَأَخْصِمُكِ إِلَى نَفْسِكَ. I will make you the judge. He said, do you remember your husband, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam? What did he used to wear? And what did he used to eat? And how did he used to live? There is no extravagance in the life of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And he continued talking and talking until she cried, remembering the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Wa alaikum assalam wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. Abu Bakr as-Siddiq radiyallahu anhu, when he died, there is nothing in his house, not one dinar or dirham, not one silver coin or a gold coin. And everything before he died, he put it in the treasury of Muslims. When he died, he had nothing left. And one time, Umar ibn Khattab saw Abu Bakr taking some material, some fabric, into the marketplace to sell. And he said, what are you doing? You are a Khalifa. What are you going to the marketplace to do? He said, we have no food in the house, so I want to make some trade so we can have some money and buy some food. And then at that time, Umar ibn al-Khattab sat down with Abu Ubaidah ibn al-Jarrah and they decided that a Khalifa should have a salary. And his salary was the food of his children. That was his salary. That was the salary of the Khalifa. That was the salary of the successor of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. two of the Sahaba that we will talk about inshaAllah, about their forsaking of the dunya and their attachment to the akhirah. How they let their money, their wealth, and their belonging be a tool in their hands and not a desire in the heart. And the first Sahabi that we will talk about is Suhaib al-Rumi. Suhaib ibn Sinan radiallahu anhu. Suhaib the Roman, as we used to be called. And the reason he is called that is Suhaib was actually the son of a governor of a city called Al-Abla. And this is, it's in Iraq today. And he was a governor on that city, the father of Suhaib. He was a governor appointed by Kisra. And one time, they were attacked by the Byzantine. There was a lot of war between the Byzantine and the Persians. And the Persians attacked that place, and they actually defeated the Persians, and they took Suhaib as a slave. He was a little boy, and he grew up under the Byzantines. So his tongue, he was speaking the language, the Latin language, the language of the Byzantine, and he grew up in their country. And then he was bought by Abdullah ibn Jad'an. He was one of the noble people of Quraysh, and he was brought to Mecca as a slave. And later on, he was freed. And he continued to be called Suhaib al-Rumi, the Suhaib the Byzantine or the Roman, because he spoke the language of the Roman, of the Byzantine Roman, and he was brought from there. And he was one of the early people that went into the house of Al-Arqam, Ibn Al-Arqam, and embraced Islam with the early elite of the Sahaba. And he spoke of himself that he made the Islam with Ammar ibn Yasir, radiallahu anhu. At the same time that Ammar ibn Yasir became a Muslim, he was a Muslim at the same time. So that is very early. That is in the first 10 to 15 Muslims. And then he said, I was with the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam in every battle, in every expedition, and in every bay'ah. And he said, I never put the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam between me and the enemy. Meaning every time there was a battle, I was between the enemy and the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. But the story about the zuhud of Suhaib al-Rumi, how he devalued dunya, comes from the event that happened to Suhaib radiallahu anhu at the time of immigration. Suhaib was one of the very few left in Mecca after most of the Sahaba made their hijrah from Mecca to Al-Madinah. And it was said that he was supposed to be with Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and Abu Bakr as-Siddiq. However, the people of Mecca knew that he was leaving. And Suhaib, after he got his freedom, became a merchant in Mecca, and he became very wealthy. He had acquired wealth because of his expertise and because of his trade. So he was a wealthy man in Mecca. And Quraysh knew that Suhaib is trying to immigrate to Al-Madinah. And Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and Abu Bakr has already left Mecca and migrated to Al-Madinah. So Suhaib tried to sneak out of Mecca and tried to follow the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam on his journey. And Quraysh sent their posse after him. They sent the chasers after Suhaib al-Rumi radiallahu anhu. And they got him. They found him on the top of a hill. And Suhaib was known of his archery, of his skills in throwing archers. So he had his arrow with him, and he had his arch and arrow, and he's stopped there on the top of the hill. And he said, Ya ma'ashara Quraysh, O people of Quraysh, لَقَدْ عَلِمْتُمْ أَنِّي مِنْ أَرْمَاكُمْ رَجُلًا. You know, I am one of the most skilled archers amongst you. وَأَيْمُ اللَّهِ لا تصلون إلي حتى أرمي كل سهم معي في كنانتي. والله, you will not get to me before I throw every arrow I have with me. ثم أضربكم بسيفي, and then I will fight you with my swords. He said, you're not taking me back to Medina. I will fight. I will throw you with my arrows and I will fight with my swords. فأقدموا إن شئتم, come if you like. And they said, أتيتنا صعلوكا فقيرا. When you came to us, you were a poor man. You had nothing. فَكَثُرَ مَالُكَ عِنْدَنَا Then you acquired all this wealth in Mecca. وَبَلَغْتَ بَيْنَنَا مَا بَلَغْتَ And you became the wealthy man that you are. وَالْآنَ تَنْطَلِقُ بِنَفْسِكَ وَبِمَالِكَ And now you want to flee with your money and yourself? And Suhaib said, إِنْ شِئْتُمْ دَلَلْتُكُمْ عَلَى مَالِي وَتَتْرُكُونِي وَشَأْنِي Said, if I give you all my money, you leave me alone, you let me go? And they said, yes. We will let you go to your religion, we'll get you, let you go to Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, but we want every single penny you have. We want all your wealth. And he said, هِيَ لَكُمْ It is hidden in such and such place. And they let him go. And the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam hasn't entered Medina yet. He was in Qiba. Qiba is a suburb of Medina where the first masjid in Islam is. And he waited and he saw Suhaib coming from afar. And he heard from the wahi, from the revelation, what happened to Suhaib en route. And he greeted Suhaib with these words. He said, رَبِحَ الْبَيْعُ يَا أَبَا يَحْيَى رَبِحَ الْبَيْعُ يَا أَبَا يَحْيَى He said, your trade is a profitable one, Abu Yahya. That was the nickname of Suhaib. He said, you made a good trade. You gave your wealth, all your wealth, all your money, so you can escape with your religion to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. He said, رَبِحَ الْبَيْعُ يَا أَبَا يَحْيَى عَلَيْكُمْ سَلَامُ That is the zuhud. That is the zuhud that we cannot really define in a word or two. He did not even think twice about the wealth and all the money that he worked years upon years in Mecca to get and acquire and accumulate. For la ilaha illallah, he said, take it. He was happy. Nothing in his heart. He thought he got a really good deal. And the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, it was a good deal, Aba Yahya. رَبِحَ الْبَيْءِ It's a profitable trade. A profitable deal, the one that you made with them. Take all your my money, take all my wealth, and I will go with la ilaha illallah. And he continued on his spending and generosity. And Umar ibn al-Khattab came to him and he said, you are extravagant. The people talk about all the feast that you put out. You feed a lot of people and you're extravagant in the way you do it. Why are you doing this? And Abu Yahya Suhaib al-Rumi, he said, I heard the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, خِيَارُكُمْ مَنْ أَفْشَى السَّلَامُ وَأَطْعَمَ الطَّعَامُ He said, the best of you, those who greet each other with salam, and they feed the other people, so I want to do as much as I can to be of the best of the Muslims. And that was the zuhud of Suhaib al-Rumi radiallahu anhu. Another sahabi that put an example of his zuhud, of his life, not attaching his heart to this dunya, is Sa'id ibn Amr. Now many of us probably haven't even heard of Sa'id ibn Amr, radiallahu anhu. When you count the famous sahaba, you may not count Sa'id ibn Amr. But Sa'id ibn Amr was not one of the early Muslims. He accepted Islam after Khaybar. So it was late in the da'wah when he accepted Islam. And before that, he was with the mushrikeen, with the pagans of Mecca. But Umar ibn al-Khattab knew who Sa'id ibn Amr was. And when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gave Ash-Sham, which was one of the wealthiest, Ash-Sham is where Syria, Jordan, Palestine, may Allah return it to the Muslims, and Lebanon is today, this whole area is called Ash-Sham. And they took Ash-Sham from Byzantium. They were looking for a governor for the most important fortress and the most important wealthiest city actually in that whole territory, and that was Homs. It was a city that's currently in Syria called Homs. And they were trying to find someone who can actually handle all that wealth and bring Islam into that city. And he said, Sa'id ibn Amr. I found him. Bring me Sa'id ibn Amr. So they brought Sa'id ibn Amr. And then Umar ibn Khattab said to Sa'id, you are the new governor of Homs. And Sa'id said, لا تفتني يا أمير المؤمنين. Don't give me this heart test. Don't give me this tribulation, Ya Amir al-Mu'mineen. He refused. He didn't want to be the governor, the Amir of the wealthiest, one of the wealthiest cities that the Muslims have. And Umar said, Wallahi la ad'ak. No, Wallahi, I will not let you. أتضعون أمانتكم وخلافتكم وخلافتكم في عنقي ثم تتركوني. He said, you give me the responsibility of this entire khilafah and then you leave me. You said, I won't take. You have to. He made him. He said, you are to go to Hims. So he went to Hims and he was a newlywed. He took his bride with him, his wife. And Umar ibn Khattab gave him a lump sum of money to as a salary, as his given amount of money for this new governor of Hims, so he can help himself, help his family, and live a life that is worthy, a decent, of a governor of that city. So his wife said, why don't we take this money and let's buy this house and let's do that and let's spend it. And she's a newlywed bride and she wants to, and her husband is the governor, so she wants to do some spending. So Sa'id ibn Amr said, أَلَا أَدُلُّكِ عَلَى خَيْرٍ مِّنْ هَذَا. Don't I just give you something better than that? And she said, what? He said, let me invest that money. He said, أَسْتَثْمِرَ. I will invest the money. And she said, well, what if we lose? What if you invest and, something happened to the marketplace, like what happened to this marketplace, stock market. What if we lose? And he said, سَأَجْعَلُ ضَمَانًا عَلَيْهِ. I will invest it in a guaranteed place. Somewhere it cannot lose. This is a guaranteed deal. And she said, okay, fine. فَنَعَمٌ إِذًا. So he went and he bought a bare minimum. Rug, the smallest house he can find in Homs, and he gave all the rest away to the poor. This entire money that he was given from Umar ibn Khattab, he said, give it all out to the poor. And every other, every now and then his wife will ask him, how is the investment doing? And he said, it's doing great. It's doing very well. Doing well. And she keeps asking him, and he said, it's doing well. And one time, one of her relatives was there, and she asked her husband, how is the investment going? How much do we have? And he said, it's going very well. And the man started laughing. The one that was there, because he knew what Sa'id ibn Amr did. And then she found out. He said, what did you do with the money? And he said, I invested it with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. There is no better investment than to invest that money with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And she said, why did you do that? And he said, لَقَدْ كَانَ لِي أَصْحَابٌ سَبَقُونِي إِلَى اللَّهِ. I have companions, they are now with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. المؤمنين رجال صدقوا ما عاهدوا الله عليه فمنهم من قضى نحبه ومنهم من ينتظر. He said, I had companions, I had brothers that preceded me and they are now with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. وما أحب أن أنحرف عن طريقهم. I don't want to deviate from their path. I want to do what they used to do. And that's how they wanted and that's how they lived. They invested more with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala than they would invest with themselves. And this Amir, this governor of Hims, had people observing some of his activities and some of his behavior, and they didn't like what he was doing. So they went to Umar ibn al-Khattab, a delegation from Hims to Umar ibn al-Khattab, to complain about Sa'id ibn Amr radiallahu anhu. And then that delegation sat down with Umar ibn al-Khattab, and they said, we have four complaints against Sa'id ibn Amr, the governor of Hims. Hims is a wealthy place, and his behavior was not understood by many of the people of Hims. He said, we have four complaints against him. لا يخرج إلينا حتى يتعالى النهار. He doesn't go out of his house until it's like kind of after sunrise, after the day broke. ولا يجيب أحدا بليل. And he doesn't respond to our needs at night. If we try to get him at night, he's not responsive. وله في الشهر يومان. لا يخرج فيهما إلينا ولا نراه. He has 2 days a month that he disappears. We don't see him. It's like he takes a vacation 2 days a month. That's not acceptable. In Crawford, Texas. وله في الشهر يومان. And he has 2 days a month that we don't see him. And they said the fourth complaint لا حيلة له فيها. He that's not his, you know, that's not his fault, but it still bothers us. لكنها تضايقنا. وأنه تأخذه الغشية. He faints every now and then. He would be sitting there and he faints. Don't you find another emir to send us? I mean, this one is, you know, it's got a lot of these faults with him. And then Umar أطرق مليا. He thought about this, and then he prayed to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. He said, اللهم إني أعرفه من خير عبادك. Oh Allah, I know that he's one of your best servants. اللهم لا تخيب فيه فراستي. Oh Allah, do not disappoint me in him. These complaints are somewhat legitimate. Why is he not responsive at night? Why does he not start his job till late in the day? Why is he late? And why does he disappear twice a month? And why does he faint every now and then? Although that's not his fault. So he called him. He called him and he came to him to Al-Madinah. And Sa'id said, أَمَّا قَوْلُهُمْ, started defending himself. فَإِنِّي لَا أَخْرُجُ إِلَيْهِمْ حَتَّى يَتَعَالَ النَّهَارِ, I don't go out until really the it's late when I start my work. He said, وَاللَّهِ كُنْتُ أَكْرَهُ أَنْ أَذْكُرَ السَّبَبِ, I hate to say what the reason was. إِنَّهُ لَيْسَ لِأَهْلِ خَادِمٍ, we have no servant in the house. فَأَنَا أَعْجُنُ الْعَجِينَ, I make the bread. وَأَدَعُهُ يَخْتَمِرْ وَأَخْبِزْ, said he gets up in the fajr and he starts making the dough and he let the dough you know, get ready, and then he makes the bread for his family, and then when the bread is ready, then he goes to the house of Imara, then he starts his job, and that's why he's late. Said, that's why I'm late. And Umar said, Alhamdulillah, that's good. And then he said, أما لا أجيب أحدا بليل, and I don't respond to them at night. He said, Wallahi, I hated to say why. ولكني جعلت النهار لهم والليل لربي, I made the day for them and the night for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. The night is for worship, for his qiyam, and to make it to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And then they said, and he said, what about the 2 days that you don't come out? You don't come out of your house. He said, ليس لي خادم يغسل ثوبي وليس لي ثوب غيره. He said, I have only one garment and I have nobody to wash it for me. He said, so what I do is I wash my clothes and I'll let it dry and then it will be ready, and at the end of the day I go out to them. And that's why these 2 days I don't go out till very late in the day. It's because I wait for my clothes to dry out in the heat of the sun. And he said, what about the fainting? Why do you faint that much? And he said, كنتُ بمكة, I was in Mecca. And I was with the mushrikeen. That was before Islam. وَجَاءَ خَبِيبُ الْأَنصَارِ. Now Khabib is one of the prisoners that were caught in the tragedy of بئر معونة, when the teachers that the Prophet ﷺ sent to the tribes were caught and they were sold in Mecca and they were taken to be killed and murdered by the people of Mecca in revenge to Badr. In revenge to Badr. So Khabib was taken by betrayal and he was brought to Mecca, and he said, I was with the Quraysh. I was with the people of Quraysh. وَقَدْ قَالُوا وَقَدْ حَمَلُوا صَلَبُوا. They took Khubayb and they crucified him and they were about to kill him. And he said, أَتُحِبُّ أَنَّ مُحَمَّدًا مَكَانَكَ وَأَنْتَ سَلِيمٌ مُعَافَى. Would you like that Muhammad صلى الله عليه وسلم be in your place and you're happy? And Khubayb said, وَاللَّهِ مَا أُحِبُّ أَنِّي فِي أَهْلِي وَوَلَدِي مَعِي عَافِيَةُ الدُّنْيَا وَيُصَابُ رَسُولُ اللَّهِ بِشَوْكَةٍ. He said, no, wallahi, I don't like to be among my children and my family, and the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is stuck with a thorn. I would rather be dead than the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam be hurt. And he said, then they killed him, and I was witnessing that, and I did not defend him. I did not defend him. And he said, every time I remember the events, I faint. Every time I remember that, and how I did not help Khubayb, I faint. And he said, أخشى عذاب الله, I'm afraid of the torment of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And then Sa'id and Umar ibn Khattab said, Alhamdulillah الذي لم يخيب فراستي, Alhamdulillah that did not disappoint me in you, go back to him. So he said, Wallahi لا أرجع إليهم أبدا, no Wallahi, it's over, I will not go back to them. And he gave up, he resigned his post as wali. When Sa'id ibn Amr radiallahu anhu would get his salary and will be any extra, they will say, توسع على أهل بيتك. Just give some to your family. I mean, give them a little extra. And he would say, ما أنا بمن أتخلف عن الرعي الأول. I will not do less than what the forefront of the Sahaba will do, that the early Sahaba will do. They said, why? He said, سمعت رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم يقول, يجمع الله عز وجل الناس للحساب, فيجيء فقراء المؤمنين يزفون كما تزف الحمائم, فيقال لهم قفوا للحساب, فيقولون ما لنا شيء نحاسب عليه, فيقول الله صدق عبادي أدخلوهم الجنة. He said, I heard the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said that when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gathers people for the day of judgment, the poor of the mu'mineen, the poor of the Muslims will come. And they will be brought in a caravan, like the elite come in a caravan, delegations. And then they tell him, stop. You have to be asked before you go into Jannah. And they said, we had nothing to be asked about. We're so poor. There is nothing, there's no money that we can be asked about. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, they are truthful. Let them go into paradise. And in the hadith, that the wealthy of the believers go into paradise half a day later than the poor of the believers, being asked about their money, being asked about how they got their money and how they spend their money. And half a day is 500 years. 500 years delay for those people who have wealth. And the poor will go into paradise before them. So he said, I wanted to keep nothing in my house and I wanted to be one of the poor. That was the concept of az-zuhd. Now subhanAllah, by comparison, if we compare our standards of living to what the Sahaba standard of living was, I dare to say that most of us are wealthy people compared to Umar ibn al-Khattab, compared to Abu Dharr al-Ghifari, compared to Sa'id ibn Amir, compared to these other people. But we have to understand, inshallah, the concept of zuhd. That concept that when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala bestow upon us the blessing of wealth, and wealth is very relative, because the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said who he wanted to ask about the poor. Who is the poor? And a man said, I am a poor man, Ya Rasulullah. And he said, do you have the food of your day? And he said, yes, I have the food of my day. And he said, you are not a poor man. And then another one said, I am a poor man, I don't have the food for today. And the other person said, the Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam told him, well, if you ask people for a loan, would they give you a loan? And he said, yes, they will. And he said, then you're not a poor man. And the third person said, I'm a poor man. And he said, can you work? He said, yes, I can work. And he said, you're not a poor man. So the concept of being poor is not what we really think. That's what I'm saying, relatively. Subhanallah, many of us, and not all of us, subhanAllah, there are still poor people there. Especially, you know, it's all relative. But we have to understand, when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala bestowed the bounty and the wealth upon us, not to let that become our life. Not to let us be busy with that. Don't let our hearts be attached to that. And let our goals be to use that wealth that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has given us in His obedience. And not to love what we have and be busy with it from what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has created us for. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said in the hadith al-Qudsi, Ibn Adam, خَلَقْتُ الْكَوْنَ لَكْ وَخَلَقْتُكَ لِي فَلَا تَنْشَغِلْ بِمَا خَلَقْتُهُ لَكْ عَمَّا خَلَقْتُكَ لَهُ. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, Ibn Adam, O son of Adam, I created the universe for you and I created you for me. مَا خَلَقْتُ الْإِنسَ وَالْجِنَّ إِلَّا لِيَعْبُدُونَ. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala created mankind and the jinn for His worship. He said to Ibn Adam, don't be busy with what I have created for you. Don't be busy with that and forsake what I have created you for, which is the worship of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. قُولُوا قَوْلِ هَذَا وَأَسْتَغْفِرُ اللَّهَ الْعَظِيمَ لِي وَلَكُمْ وَيَا فَوْزَ الْمُسْتَغْفِرِينَ.